Right. So, slide number five, we start out with an image of the female reproductive system. And you can see in the middle, we have the uterus and the oviducts extending out to the sides and then extending out to the ovaries that are on either side. And at the bottom of the uterus, you see the cervix. And below that is the vagina, of course. All right, so the very first slide, we're going to be talking about the ovary. And now the ovary, what we're looking at is an ovary showing changes that occur over the course of about 28 days, which is the duration of the ovarian cycle. Now, so the ovarian cycle is the cycle of changes that happens to the within the ovary approximately every month. And I guess on average it's every 28 days. That of course varies from person to person. So if you look at this, when you look at it, you can see, I want you to look carefully at the image. So this is on slide number six. Look carefully at the image and find the primordial follicles. And it's sort of, if you're looking at the ovary, it's here in this upper left sort of corner from the viewer's perspective. And so you see these primordial follicles. Now, what happens? It's impossible to talk about this without talking about the hormones. And we've already started talking about them a little bit, but I'm going to reiterate some of the stuff we already learned because it's complicated. So, over the course of this ovarian cycle, what happens with a woman is at the very beginning of the ovarian cycle, she has very low sex hormones. The estrogen and progesterone are very low. And so, because of the lack of inhibition by high sex hormones, follicle stimulating hormone is secreted from the anterior pituitary. Okay, and so again, we've already introduced these hormones and now I'm kind of elaborating on them. So, because at this time in the cycle, at the very beginning of the cycle, you have very low estrogen and progesterone. Normally, estrogen and progesterone will be, if the levels are high, it's going to be inhibiting the release of follicle stimulating hormone. And the reason for that is so that you get only one group of follicles being produced during each of these ovarian cycles. Okay, so we have this low female sex hormone condition, and as a result of that, follicle stimulated hormone is secreted. And we had talked, and so now, you're starting in the sort of upper left corner, and we're going to work our way around in this ovary picture. So now, as a result of the secretion of follicle stimulating hormone, a group of primordial follicles will start to mature, a group of them, four or five. And as they mature, they are going to become larger and fluid-filled. And what did we say is in that fluid? Estrogen. So as a result of the development of these follicles, we start to produce estrogen, and the estrogen levels, as they rise, it starts to inhibit the release of the follicle stimulating hormone. And so that's why we have this group of follicles that are going to mature, and then at the end, we'll talk about it all starts over again. So as these four or five follicles are maturing, they're producing estrogen, and so serum estrogen levels start to rise. And now, and as they're maturing, in effect, they're competing. Now, what I really mean by that is that eventually, one after another of them will regress and stop maturing until you only have one. You have one dominant follicle. And this one dominant follicle can be very large compared to the size of the ovary. The picture does not show it in realistic size because it will literally cover half of the ovary. So because of this, you know, we have this large fluid-filled follicle that is produced, that's filled with estrogen. And so the estrogen levels are really rising. And so because of that, about halfway through the model 28-day cycle, the luteinizing hormone starts to be secreted by the anterior pituitary. Now, what did we say about it? We said it is released in response to high levels of estrogen. So here we are. We're talking again about the interrelatedness of these hormones. So because of the high levels of estrogen, because of the follicle, eventually you start getting these pulses of luteinizing hormone that result in ovulation. And what is ovulation about? On day 14, on day 14, we get a large pulse of luteinizing hormone, which causes the release of the mature oocyte or ovum, egg. They're all synonyms, the same thing. It gets released. Now, I'm going to just continue talking. I mean, you know, obviously we need to follow the egg, but we're going to continue talking about this ovary. And so after the ovary has released the egg, it becomes something called a corpus luteum. And that means a yellow body. So corpus meaning body, and I guess luteum must mean yellow. So, but the corpus luteum, it's not just a residual structure. It has a function. And that function is to start producing progesterone. So progesterone is pretty similar to estrogen, but it has a different function. What it does is it prevents the uterus from losing the uterine lining. Now, later on in our story, we're going to talk about how if the egg was fertilized, it's going to implant, become attached to the endometrium, the uterine lining. And so the uterine lining has to get ready. Now, you've just ovulated the egg, so it's too early even for fertilization to have happened, but your body won't know for a couple of weeks whether or not that egg gets fertilized. So for a couple of weeks, that corpus luteum is going to secrete progesterone. And now if you didn't get pregnant, the corpus luteum becomes something called a corpus albicans, a white body. And this is just a scar. This, it doesn't do anything. And that's at the end of the 28 days. So if you think about it, throughout that entire first half of the ovarian cycle, we had high estrogen levels, and then we start producing high progesterone levels, and the progesterone is also going to be inhibitory on the follicle stimulating hormone. So if we just say, okay, we didn't get pregnant, what happens is that corpus luteum became a corpus albicans, and that should be the last thing on our circle there. It is, I looked. And so at that point, what happens to the serum female hormone concentrations? They tank. And that's what then triggers the menstrual cycle. So I have just now, I have walked through what we would call the ovarian cycle. And now whether or not this is the proper place for me to have done it or not, it doesn't even matter. I've done it now, and I'm just looking at the slide, and it's talking about something unrelated to that ovarian cycle, but I wanted to cover it when it was in my head. There's something called atresia. So remember, we had said that once a month, 4 or 5 of these primordial follicles will mature. And so over the course of, say, a 30-year reproductive period in a woman's life, 4 or 5 per month doesn't translate into millions of eggs, right? It's, you know, hundreds or thousands. I haven't done the math, and I don't care to do the math, but it's not millions. And so you have originally in the ovary, you have millions of eggs. You have 2 million primordial follicles with a primordial potential oocyte, ovum, in them. And as a result, throughout life, women will lose these primordial follicles in a process called atresia. It doesn't matter because you have way more than you need, but it is something we talk about. All right, so I've spent the entire 11 minutes and a half talking about one slide, but that's okay. It was one of the processes we needed to discuss.